Hi, very good morning. I'm Dr. Janak Patel. I'm an MD general physician. Today we'll be discussing on another interesting topic, and good number of time you will see that particular case in your everyday practice, that is Fallot's tetralogy, or it is also called as tetralogy of Fallot. So tetralogy of Fallot, or also called as TOF, that is tetralogy of Fallot or Fallot's tetralogy. It is a congenital cyanotic heart disease. There are few congenital cyanotic heart disease. We also call it 60. One most common tetralogy of Fallot, tricuspid atresia or Epstein anomaly, transposition of great arteries, or we call transposition of great vessels, total anomalous pulmonary venous drainage, truncus arteriosus, pulmonary atresia with VSD, very common, quite common, or it is also called as total achardia or ectopic achardia also. There is one condition we call as ectopic achardia. These are all congenital cyanotic heart disease group. Ectopia cordis, or sometimes single ventricle, or we call double outlet right ventricle, left side hypoplastic heart or right side hypoplastic heart. There is another called Fallot's pentalogy and Fallot's trialogy. We are going to discuss today only on malformation of TOF, that is Fallot's tetralogy. There are four malformations. One, obstruction to the right ventricular outflow, that is infundibular pulmonary stenosis. It is not a valvular stenosis, but it is infundibular pulmonary stenosis associated with ventricular septal defect. And because of ventricular septal defect and infundibular pulmonary stenosis, there is dextroposition of aorta, means aorta is also opening into right ventricle, or second word utilized is overriding of aorta. And due to this, there is a right ventricular hypertrophy. So there are four components. That's why it is called tetra. Tetra means four. So it is most common cyanotic congenital heart disease, and it is accounting for nearly 9 to 10% of congenital heart disease. Total congenital heart disease, out of that it is 9 to 10%. The most common is ASD, VSD and PDA, of which VSD is more common. So Fallot's tetralogy, we already told you, infundibular pulmonary stenosis, ventricular septal defect, right ventricular hypertrophy and overriding of aorta. Now if a person has got tetralogy of Fallot with ASD, then we call it a pentalogy. And if there is an ASD with patent foramen ovale, right ventricular hypertrophy and pulmonary stenosis, so it is ASD with RVH with pulmonary stenosis, then we call that as a trialogy. Now see here, there is no VSD. In this particular trialogy, there is no VSD. Instead of VSD, there is ASD. But if there is a VSD, ASD plus pulmonary stenosis, right ventricular hypertrophy, and there is an overriding of aorta, then we call that as a pentalogy. So TOF plus ASD is pentalogy. There is good number of time associated with tetralogy is right ventricular outtrack obstruction, which may be infundibular, which may be 10% of the time it is valvular level, or maybe combined, 30% of the time combined. But the most common is infundibular stenosis, and very rarely there is a complete pulmonary atresia. Now this particular is very frequently associated with mitral wall hypoplastic, and right side aortic is 25%, and good number of time there will be abnormal coronary artery. So depending upon the severity, it is divided to mild, moderate and severe. In a severe variety, almost there is a pulmonary atresia, while in a mild variety there is a very mild pulmonary infundibular stenosis, and good number of time they are not cyanotic, Etiology wise, if you go through, the most common etiology is genetic Down syndrome, or we also call it a trisomy 18. Another group, radiation, teratogenic drugs, chemicals, etc. It is almost accounting for 9% of the disease in congenital heart disease, and most common cyanotic congenital heart disease. It is, we have already told you, 9 to 10% of congenital heart disease, and it is giving rise to right to left shunt. That's why it will produce deoxygenated blood entering into the oxygenated side, producing cyanosis. There are extra cardiac manifestation in 10% of the people, and this may be associated in good number of conditions like Apert anomaly, Silver syndrome, Goldenhainer syndrome, DeLange syndromes, fetal hydantoin syndromes, carbamazepine syndrome, fetal alcohol syndrome, etc. There are many conditions where tetralogy of Fallot is associated with VSD, or it is associated with ASD, that is we call as a pentology. It may be associated with PDA or double outlet right ventricle, etc. There are a lot of anomaly, and these are because of some of the common drug toxicity or teratogenicity, and that is quite common. As far as pathophysiology is concerned, very easy to understand. Because of pulmonary stenosis, now right ventricle will face increase in afterload at the level of pulmonary artery opening. So because of increased resistance, now more blood will flow through VSD into aorta and LV. So blood from right ventricle will go to aorta because there is no resistance in aorta. There is less resistance as compared to pulmonary artery opening, because aorta is overriding into RV because of associated with VSD. So as there is a VSD, the blood can easily enter into LV and it will enter into aorta. Less blood will go to pulmonary. As less blood goes to pulmonary, the whatever quantity of blood goes to pulmonary artery circulation, that gets oxygenated. So there is a decreased blood flow in a pulmonary vasculature. Because of decreased blood flow in a pulmonary vasculature, less blood is going to pulmonary circulation. So that blood gets oxygenated. Oxygenated blood comes to LA, LV. But there is more blood coming from RV into LV, and more blood is going into aorta, which is deoxy blood from RV. Hence, in aorta, there is two types of a blood. Deoxy plus oxy blood, which is it has received from LA, LV. So there is a mixture of blood. Deoxy blood received from RV and oxygenated blood received from LA. And that will produce central cyanosis. And because right ventricle has to do more work against pulmonary resistance, right ventricle undergoes hypertrophy. So these are the four components. Overriding of aorta, infundibular pulmonary stenosis, ventricular septal defect, and right ventricular hypertrophy. So that is the basic pathophysiology. Very clearly understood. So this is VSD. So because of VSD, now aorta is almost opening into RV. That's why it is called overriding of aorta. There is an infundibular pulmonary stenosis. So there is increased resistance to pulmonary blood flow. RV has to do more work. RVH. And secondary to this particular, so there are four components: infundibular pulmonary stenosis, overriding of aorta, VSD, and RVH. Now, as if infundibular stenosis is very severe enough, then right ventricle will undergo more and more hypertrophy, and finally, you will have a right ventricular pressure elevation, right atrial pressure elevation, and you will have a symptom signs of congestive cardiac failure. Now, because of tight stenosis, more oxygenated blood is going into aorta, and person will develop central cyanosis. If a person gets severe hypoxia because of more blood, deoxy blood entering into aorta, and demand becomes more, whenever a person is doing some activity, he will get hypoxic spell, or we call TAT spell. And during that tight spell, because of severe hypoxia, person can get even syncopal episode. Person can become unconscious and he can also have seizures. Now, during this particular tight spell, if a person takes squatting posture, so I'm explaining what will happen during that particular episode. So whenever he takes a squatting posture, because of squatting posture, he bends hip joint, he flexes at hip joint. So there is a kinking of femoral arteries. Because of that, there's an increased aortic resistance. So there is an increased resistance in aorta. Because of increased resistance in aorta, now more blood will enter into pulmonary artery. And as more blood enters, more blood gets oxygenated. More oxygenated blood will come to LA. So that will provide more oxygenated blood into aorta and person will get relief from hypoxia. And because of hypoxia, person will develop metabolic acidosis, anaerobic metabolism, and person will also have acidosis. So that will be what will be happening. So this is a normal thing what is being happening because of severe pulmonary stenosis, right ventricle hypertrophy, right ventricle has to do more work and it will result in cyanosis and hypoxia. So very simple to understand, because of pulmonary stenosis, resistance is more. So more blood will flow from right ventricle via VSD into LV as well as into aorta. So there will be increased blood flow, but it will be deoxygenated blood entering into systemic circulation. So there is cyanosis, hypoxia, person can get anoxic spell, or we call cyanotic spell, or we call tach spell. And because of chronic hypoxia, person will develop central cyanosis with clubbing. Also there will be delay in growth, etc. And there's a decreased blood flow in pulmonary circulation. So there is a pulmonary oligemia. Less blood comes to LA. And LV is receiving blood from LA as well as from right ventricle because of VST. So during hypoxic spell, I have already explained you, there's an infundibular spasm or there's an increased resistance. So because of increased resistance, there is more blood will be flowing through VSD into systemic circulation, that is aorta. More hypoxia, more metabolic acidosis, more production of lactic acid, giving rise to syncopal episode, or we call hypoxic spell or cyanotic spell, or it is also called as a tach spell. So that is the thing what is happening. And secondary to this, now the person, if he develops a severe hypoxia, person can get even convulsions. Now if a person acquires a squatting posture, I already explained you, on squatting posture, venous return is decreased. Systemic resistance is increased because of kinking of the lower limb vessels. So blood from RV into aorta is reduced. So deoxy blood going from RV into aorta is reduced. More blood will enter into pulmonary artery. More blood gets oxygenated. More oxygenated blood will come to LA. And from LA to LV, and it will enter into aorta, providing more oxygenated blood. So this will be the typical posture, or we call it the squatting posture. So there will be increased right to left shunting. And secondary to that increased right to left shunting, person is developing severe hypoxia, increased CO2, and what we call is a metabolic acidosis because of more lactic acid production. And when he gets this acquired squatting posture, there is an increase in peripheral vascular resistance. Because of increase in peripheral vascular resistance, more blood is entering into pulmonary circulation, and that is how the person gets relief. So that is what is happening during a cyanotic spell, or we call hypoxic spell. As far as clinical feature is concerned, in a mild variety of pulmonary stenosis, as good quantity of blood is entering into pulmonary artery, there is relatively good quantity of oxygenated blood coming to the left side into LA, LV and aorta. Less deoxy blood from RV is entering into aorta. Hence, person does not have a severe hypoxia. By and large, good number of times they are asymptomatic. if there is severe, moderate to severe variety of pulmonary stenosis, then person will have a afterload on right ventricle, increased pulmonary resistance, increased pulmonary hypertension. And because of that, deoxy blood will be entering into aorta, giving rise to hypoxia. And now person will be symptomatic. Person will have a cyanosis, clubbing, dyspnea. By and large, it is a drumstick clubbing. Because of hypoxia, if it is very tight pulmonary stenosis, person can get cyanotic spell. Because of chronic hypoxia, appetite is reduced, there is impaired growth. Because of chronic hypoxia, person will develop a polycythemia because there is release of erythropoietin from juxtaglomerular apparatus. And because of polycythemia, now person develops what we call as a hyperviscosity syndrome. And secondary to hyperviscosity syndrome, person can have a CNS symptoms and signs. Now, because there is a right to left shunt, a thrombus on the right side can produce a paradoxical thromboembolism, which can directly enter into aorta and can produce systemic thromboembolization, we call paradoxical thromboembolization. Person can develop infective endocarditis, and secondary to infective endocarditis, again person can have paradoxical thromboembolization. Now, because there is an increased load on the right ventricle, that is afterload, depending upon the severity, person will develop pulmonary hypertension, right ventricular hypertrophy, right side pressure elevation, and then person might show symptom signs of congestive cardiac failure. So dyspnea, cyanosis increases on exertion, person gets cyanotic spell, or we call TET spell or hypoxic spell. And by acquiring a sweating posture, it is reduced. There is growth retardation. So you can divide into three groups: severe pulmonary stenosis or pulmonary atresia, mortality is very high. Group two, usually they are symptomatic from 6 months of life. And group three, they are usually pink, they are less cyanotic, so they are called pink TOF, or it is also called as acyanotic TOF, where there is a very mild pulmonary stenosis with VSD, less amount of blood is entering into left side, more blood is entering because there is not much amount of resistance given by pulmonary stenosis, hence person is usually not cyanosed. And by and large, he is asymptomatic. That we call as a class 3. That is, we call as a group 3. Or pink phallotstetrology. The word utilized is pink phallotstetrology. So, as far as cardiovascular system examination is concerned, RVH. Because of RVH, there is right ventricular heave. Pulmonary hypertension gives rise to P2 loud. There is a harsh murmur, usually at the level of VSD. Then depending upon the severity of pulmonary stenosis, you will get clinical symptoms and signs. Person can develop TET spell, and symptom signs of severe hypoxia can occur. So TET spell usually is very common in a person with tight stenosis. During crying or feeding or defecation, etc., can precipitate TET spell, or during activity can precipitate TET spell. There may be a paroxysmal attack of cardiac arrhythmias, particularly tachyarrhythmias. I've already mentioned regarding what can happen during that TET spell, severe spell. Very frequently, the person will have a central cyanosis, which worsens with exercise or fast breathing. There's a clubbing, there's an anoxic spell, there will be delayed growth, dyspnea, and because of increased right ventricular pressure, person can also have a symptom signs of congestion. This is the typical posture during a cyanotic spell, person gets to relieve that hypoxia. So, person with tetralogy of Fallot can have heart failure, polycythemia, increased thromboembolism, cerebral infarct. They can also develop infective endocarditis and paradoxical embolization, leading to brain abscess, meningitis, etc. in case of infective endocarditis. This is showing you cyanosis plus drumstick clubbing. This is polycythemia. Because of polycythemia, there's a cyanosis with clubbing. As far as investigation is concerned, X-ray chest will show you typical RVH. There will be decreased pulmonary vascular marking. We call it a pulmonary oligemia. ECG will show you RVH with strain pattern. P pulmonal, P will be tall. Echocardiography will demonstrate all, that is overriding of aorta. Interventricular septum defect, that is ventricular septal defect. Depending upon the severity, you will demonstrate infundibular pulmonary stenosis or very rarely valvular pulmonary stenosis. And in some cases, you can have a pulmonary atresia. And there is a right ventricular muscle mass is increased. So there is a right ventricular hypertrophy. You can have a gradient. You can demonstrate thromboembolism. You can have even infective endocarditis demonstrable on echocardiography. If you want to find out the other defects, etc., you might have to go for an angiography and then try to find out how severe, is there any presence of any other abnormality, coronary blood flow, etc. You can demonstrate that, which cannot be demonstrable by echocardiography. So mainly to study coronary blood flow and other defects, angiography is being done preoperative. It is by and large preoperative. We already mentioned on examination you will have a to and fro murmur, very loud murmur, heard in a parasternal region on the left side. X-ray chest will show you mild cardiomegaly of RV type. There will be what we call as a pulmonary oligemia. ECG will show you RVH, P pulmonal. And you can go for what we call as angiographic studies. These are what we already get. We already mentioned that you will have a boot-shaped heart, oligemic field. You might have a right side rib erosion because of a collateral which are being developed. And particularly if the blood lactosic shunt is being done, you will have a right side rib notching. You will have an aneurysmal bulging of a pulmonary artery with absence of pulmonary arch, pulmonary wall. In some of the cases, you can have that finding. This is typical boot-shaped heart. Typical boot-shaped heart you can get. We already told you on ECG, you will have a right axis deviation, RVH, and P pulmonar. Typical RVH. V1 will have a tall R wave, AVR will have a R wave, and you will have a tall P wave in lead 2. So that will be, and S wave will be there in lead 1, AVL and V5, V6. S wave will be prominent in those leads, showing you RVH. Echocardiography, I already mentioned, what you finding, you will come across all four findings, that is overriding of aorta, ventricular septal defect, right ventricular hypertrophy, and severity of pulmonary stenosis, particularly infundibular stenosis. You will be very easily be able to identify, and condition of pulmonary wall. All those can be easily identified. In blood examination, you will get polycythemia. You might have a microcytic hypochromic anemia. You will have to differentiate from other condition like VSD with pure pulmonary stenosis. So if a person has got VSD with pulmonary stenosis, that is one of the close differential diagnosis. Other congenital cyanotic heart disease or cyanotic congenital heart disease, Fallot's pentology, Fallot's triology, you should differentiate. That is easily differentiable by doing a good echo and by doing angiography. So echo is a main important part. As far as management is concerned, in a medical side, or we call as a pharmacological therapy, treatment of iron deficiency anemia, correction of polycythemia by phlebotomy, and beta blocker can be utilized in, and it may be helpful in some of the cases. But by and large, it is a surgical treatment we call palliative treatment, which is blood lactosic shunt, or you can have a total correction. So these are the two modes. First is pharmacological or conservative line of treatment, that is correction of anemia, correction of polycythemia, and you can use a beta blocker. And surgical treatment wise, what is being done is you have a blalactosic shunt, means you connect one of the artery from arch of aorta to left pulmonary artery, so more blood flows into pulmonary circulation, so more blood gets oxygenated. This is called blalactosic shunt. So you have a shunt to either a right pulmonary artery or a left pulmonary artery. Depending upon the type of that shunt, different names are given. So blalactosic shunt, water shunt, pot shunt, etc. So these are different. This is modified blalactosic. Classical blalactosic is you left side subclavian is anastomosed with left pulmonary artery, and when the right side subclavian is anastomosed with right pulmonary, it is called modified blalactosic. And when you do aorta anastomosis with pulmonary artery directly, it is water shunt shunts. And if the right descending aorta is anastomosed with left side pulmonary artery, it is called pot shunt. So depending upon that, name are given. But basically you want a blood from aorta going into pulmonary artery, so more blood goes into pulmonary circulation, more blood will get oxygenated and hypoxia will be relieved. So those are the different types of shunts which you can go for. There are other procedures we call as a corrective procedures which can be done. Those are Norwood procedures, etc. As far as medical therapy is concerned, in a polycythemia, you can have a what we call as phlebotomy. Beta blocker is given. It is partially beneficial. And oral ion therapy is given, or sometimes you need a blood transfusion also, because a person is, no doubt the hemoglobin is good. In spite of polycythemia, they might develop even microcytic hypochromic anemia. So in that case, you will have to give oral ion or repeated blood transfusion. When a person gets tet spell, by and large, knee chest position, controlled crying, you might need oxygen supplements. If it is severe enough, then morphine, hydration, correction of metabolic acidosis, beta blockers, correct anemia, and then last part is surgical intervention to prevent repeat episodes. So morphine, propranolol, phenylephrine, etc. are useful. Supportive treatment like knee chest position, oxygen, this is a typical sweating posture, soda bicarb for correction of acidosis, prevention of episodes, propranolol, and treatment of anemia by giving iron supplements. Very, very helpful to reduce cyanotic spell. So these are all the different spells treatment. We have told you in a polycythemia, avoid dehydration, and phlebotomy is very, very important. Prophylaxis for infective endocarditis can be given, and also in a person who is likely to develop infective endocarditis, you can give antibiotic as a prophylactic. So acyanotic tetralogy of Fallot will become gradually cyanotic. Treatment of polycythemia, treatment of anemia, prevention of hypoxic spell, prophylaxis for infective endocarditis, etc. is more required. Complication, very frequently complications are because of polycythemia, paradoxical embolization, infective endocarditis, impaired growth, congestive cardiac failure, or we call right ventricular failure, cyanotic spell or hypoxic spell, or we call as a TAC spell, and you can have a hypoxic damage to the brain, and you can have a paradoxical embolization leading to systemic involvement. Other complication we already mentioned, secondary to polycythemia, central venous thrombosis, we call as a cerebral venous thrombosis, infective endocarditis producing cerebral abscess, etc. You can have arthropathy, AKI, bleeding diastasis, delayed puberty. All those are very common. I end my lecture here. I hope this will be very helpful. This is the most common cyanotic congenital heart disease. Very frequently you will see in your practice. If you keep in mind, if you diagnose them early, you will be able to treat them. You will be able to treat them. Early diagnosis will prevent complications.